Seated in the bus, coming back from La Union, and we knew that the next day was the medical mission, the hardest day, the hottest day, the dirtiest day. It would be in Payatas in the slum. Pastor Rene turned around, he looked at me, he says, by the way, we haven't talked about, and I looked at him, and I said, who's going to preach on Sunday? And he said, yes. And God always gives extra grace at times like this. And I said, well, the Lord understands, and I think it's going to be either the anniversary message at Iloilo or the anniversary message at La Union. Do you know what Pastor Rene said to me? He said, oh, Pastor Jennifer, that was really a good message in La Union. We're going to turn this morning, we're going to look at, it will be some of the same things that we talked about in La Union, but I prayed about it. I've prayed and prepared and added to, and I believe this is the Lord's message for us today. We're going to be talking about a high calling and a worthy life. It's two parts of it. And it's coming from mostly from the writings of Paul. And in La Union, at the church there, as they had prayed about it, God gave them this verse as their theme for the anniversary. And so we'll begin with what Paul says in Ephesians 4:1, and then we're going to look at some other verses. And in Ephesians 4:1, Paul begins by saying, as a prisoner for the Lord then. I want you to stop and think for just a minute about what Paul says here. He says, a prisoner of the Lord. That's nice and poetic. And it sounds like, oh, he was saying that his life was the Lord's. And he was saying that. And so part of the meaning of this is, God, I am your prisoner. That means, Paul was saying, I have given up the rights of my life to you. My life is not my own. And in those days, in the Roman understanding of a prisoner and in a Roman prison, prisoners had no rights, really. They had no rights. And Paul is, in essence, he is saying, God, my life is completely yours. I don't have control of part of my life to say, okay, God, here, part of this is yours, part of this is mine. But Paul was saying, I am your prisoner. All of my life is yours. So that is part of it. And a question for us this morning is, does that describe our lives as well? For some of us, perhaps that's true, but for a lot of people, and it's very common, a lot of people have the idea, well, God, I'm doing good things for you, so part of my life is yours, but part of my life is mine. I remember one time many years ago, I was at a student conference in China, and I met this young man. I think he was from, his name, I won't tell you his name. And he was from Nigeria, and he was so sincere. He loved God, and he wanted to talk with me, and he gave me a little card that he laminated with his plan for his life, his goals for his life. And it was very specific, and he had it all worked out, and he'd already decided that he was going to have 4 children. He wasn't married yet, and he didn't have a girlfriend, but he was going to have 4 children. And then he said, and I'm going to give, and he was quite, I don't want to say it in a bad way, but he was quite pleased, I mean, quite proud, and he was sincere. And he said, I'm going to have 4 children, and I'm going to give one of them to God. And so I looked at him, and I listened, and I said, but they're all God's. And he looked at me, but his idea was, you know, with these others, they're going to be maybe doctors or this or that or whatever, but this one can be a pastor or maybe a missionary. But God wants, he loves us so much, he wants all that we are and all that we have. Not because he's a greedy God, not because he doesn't want us to have a good time or fun in this life, but because he loves us so much and he knows that all of our lives and all that we have and all that we are in his hands will be the most contented that we could ever be, will be the happiest that we could ever be, will be the most fulfilled that we could ever be. And that's really true. And Paul understood that. And so he said, I'm a prisoner for the Lord. I'm a prisoner for the Lord. Are you a prisoner for the Lord this morning? Are you a prisoner for the Lord? And praise the Lord, I heard somebody say, yes, That's the right answer. That's the right answer. And if we're not yet, we can be. We can be. I was so challenged this week, as these past 2 weeks, as we were in the Philippines with these wonderful missionaries whose lives are completely God's, whose homes are completely God, whose pocketbooks and time, they're completely God's. It was a challenge to each one of us as we were with them. And so Paul says, a prisoner for the Lord, I urge you. But he wasn't just speaking nice spiritual words. Paul was literally a prisoner for the Lord as he wrote this letter to the Ephesians. For the sake of God's work, he had been captured and imprisoned, and he was behind bars as he wrote this. Sometimes following the Lord is easy. Sometimes the Christian life is a life of blessing and sunshine and ease. But there are other times when it is not easy, and there are storms and not sun, and there are deep valleys and not mountaintops, and there is trouble and not peace. That can be the life of the Christian. And in those times, we are still the prisoners of the Lord. We're still the prisoners of the Lord. And in those times, God is still with us. He's still with us. And there's a price to pay for following the Lord. There really is. There really is. If we don't want to pay the price to follow the Lord, we don't have to. Paying the price is always our choice. God never demands this of us. And some of us, you say, well, wow, Pastor Jennifer, you sure did start out strong. Couldn't you have told a joke and eased into this? Nope. I've just come from the Philippines. And there's always a price. There is a price to pay. And sometimes it won't be that easy. But what we have seen is it's always worth it. These people that we were working with in these last 2 weeks, may I tell you, not one of them came to us on the side and said, you know, it's really hard. It is so difficult. Every one of them, truly every one of them, was just overflowing with joy and thanksgiving. Truly, truly. And it was a challenge to me as well. And it'd be a challenge to you as well, just to see their heart and their attitude, because they've paid the price and they have found great joy in paying the price. And then Paul goes on to say, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. So that's where the title comes from this morning, to live a life worthy of the calling you've received. And when he says urge, it's a really strong word. If we read Greek, this is what we would know. The word in the Greek actually means to pull someone to come alongside, either to help you or you to help them. It's really strong. It's like come, so that there can be a help or mutual help. And so he says, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you've received. He doesn't mince words, and he doesn't make it easy. And I think the reason he doesn't make it easy, and the reason I think he says these things so confidently, is because Paul has paid this price, right? Have you ever been around people that have really smooth words about God and about the Christian life? And they say things to you, but then you wonder about their own lives. Maybe they haven't really paid the price. When I'm around that, I'm very skeptical. I'm very cautious. But for the person, when I'm around somebody that they have paid the price to follow the Lord, I really want to listen to them, because I know their words are worthy words. I know their words have weight, and they've paid a price, and I can listen to those words, and I can trust those words, and so can you, and so can you. And so Paul says, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you've received. We're going to talk about the calling of the Lord, and we're going to talk about living a worthy life. If you read throughout the New Testament, you will find in most of the letters that Paul writes, and Peter as well, they talk about living a worthy life. We're going to talk about what that is. What does it mean to live a worthy life? And then what is the calling of God, and how do we live a worthy life? This is one message this morning, so we certainly can't cover it all. And this is a simple message. If you'll remember, about 2 or 3 years ago, I talked about living a worthy life. Do you remember that? Hope you do. If not, you can go back and check the archives of Lighthouse. I didn't go back and check my notes. This was okay, Lord, for today. But if you read the New Testament, you will find Paul and Peter, there are three words they use for the calling of God. And in English, anyhow, they all begin with H. And the calling of God is a high calling, it's a holy calling, and it's a heavenward calling. Okay, so it's a high calling, a holy calling, and a heavenward calling. We won't go into detail with that this morning, but I want to say something first of all to each one of us. As we think about the calling that we have received, I say this to you first. If you are a child of God this morning, you're a Christian, Jesus lives in your life, then you have heard the calling of God and you have responded to the calling of God. Because the first calling of God to anyone in any life is the call of salvation, always. It's the call of salvation. It is the call of God to our hearts. And that call is, I love you, come to me. That call is, I will set you free. That call is, I have a plan for your life. If you will trust me with your life, come to me and give me your life. That call is a call, I love you and I want to be in relationship with you. Come to me so that we can be in relationship. And it is the call of salvation. And if you're a child of God this morning, you've heard that, haven't you? Remember when God first began to stir your heart? I love hearing testimonies from so many of you. And you say, these were the steps. This is how it began. For some of you, boom, it was a strong, loud voice right away. For others, it was a whisper and it came step by step by step. But God, there's a calling on our lives. And the first call is the call to salvation. So let me say something to others of us this morning. I don't know everyone here. I don't know your lives. But I also want to say this to you. Whether you have heard His voice or not this morning, if you are not yet a child of God, God has a calling on your life. And He is saying those things to you that you just heard me say. And He's saying, I love you and I have a good plan for your life. If you will give me your life, I will take care of you. I will work things out. I will give you my life. This is the call of God in salvation to everyone. And the enemy will always try to stop the ears of anyone who hears the call. He'll try to distract. He'll try to take away. He'll try to distort in any way. But the call of God is on each of us. It's on our lives. And so here, first of all, is the calling that we receive. So we've received a calling. To help us understand this a little bit more, let's look at Colossians 1. We're going to look at 3 through 14. And you say, wow, Pastor Jennifer, how are we going to cover this in the 30 minutes remaining? We're going to cover it, but we're going to do it quickly. Let's look at this always. Paul is writing, and this reminds me of where we have been in the Philippines in these last 2 weeks. Because when Paul writes, look at what Paul says. He says, I thank God when I pray for you. Look at verse 4. He says, because we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have. Ah, so Paul is writing to people and he's praying for people he has never even met. He's never even met. And that encourages me, and it should encourage us, because, you know, Lighthouse is a strong missions church. And sometimes we think, well, who are all these people that live over there in Bagumbong or whatever? I'll never go there. I haven't heard of them. I haven't seen their faces and I don't know. But Paul gives us a different way to look at it. He says, when I've heard about you and the gospel and the truth that has sprung up in your lives and there's joy there and there's the love of God there, I pray for you and I thank God for you. So here's something, as we hear these things, that we can respond to the Lord in for these new people. This 85-year-old couple that received the Lord in Payata slum, that I think would not have received the Lord if we had not gone, and would be on the way to hell. Another woman, I was in the reading glass section in her 80s. I took a picture of her, and then after we'd helped her with reading glasses, she was so thankful. And then she said, I want you to, there's no one who prays for me. Would you pray for me? And so we gathered around her, and the young girl that was helping us, who was, I think April Lynn was maybe 17 or something like that. April Lynn is Zenny's daughter. She was helping us, and we said, April Lynn, you lead. And as lead us in prayer, and as April Lynn prayed for her, this small, she must have been, I don't know if she was 40 kg. I don't think she was. She was so small and so tiny. And as we prayed, she began to cry. She began to weep. And then afterwards, she said, I felt something in my heart. And then she said, the Holy Spirit has come into my heart. And then she said, I want a Bible. I want to learn about Jesus. I want to know about Jesus. And so then we called Susan over and we said, Susan, you could have a Bible study here in this house. Praise the Lord. Salvation came. And Paul talks about this. He says, you've heard the word of truth. In verse 6, this word has come to you. All over the world, this gospel is bearing fruit and growing, just as it has been doing among you since the day you heard it and understood God's grace in all its truth. And brothers and sisters, here's a picture for us this morning. We tend to be very insular. Let me explain that. We tend to look at people that are just like us, or people only from our own home, or our own type of people, or our own family, and those are the ones we're interested in. Those are the ones we love. Those are the ones that we're connected with. Paul wasn't that way at all. He saw the gospel going out and fruit coming, and he realized we're all in this together. We're all in the family of God. And he says the gospel's bearing fruit in you since the day you heard it. And then look at verse 7. He says, you learned it from Epaphras, our dear fellow servant. So I want you to pause for just a minute this morning, and I want you to think back, and I want to ask you, when did you first hear the gospel? By word or by deed or by life? How did you come to salvation? How did you come to really understand God's love and God's truth? Think about it for just a minute. Was it somebody who came from another place? Was it a husband who shared with you? Was it a wife? Was it a friend? It may have been something you even heard on television or something that you read. And think for just a minute how much God loved you. He loved you so much that he brought somebody into your life who would share with you the gospel of love and the gospel of life. And then here's the other question for you to think about. Have you done that and been that in somebody else's life this morning? Have you been? God calls us to be. God calls us to be. We don't just receive, but we also give out. And he says, you learned about it from Epaphras. Who did Epaphras hear it from? Perhaps from Paul. Perhaps he heard it from Paul. We don't know. The Bible doesn't tell us exactly, but they were co-workers. And God has brought people into our lives. For me, it was my parents, really godly parents, but I had a grandmother who really prayed for me as well, and a great aunt who really prayed for me. And so there are people that you won't meet until heaven, you won't know until heaven, but they were praying for you, or they were praying for your country. They were praying for your country, and they knew, I'll never go there. I'll never be able to go to that country. I'll never be able to go to that place. But God, pour out your love and pour out your spirit in that place. Bring fruit from that place. And so some of these cities we're talking about, some of these barangays we're talking about this morning, you will probably never go there. But do you want to have a part in spreading the gospel? You can get it on your heart and start praying for them. You really can. But don't just look too far afield. Look at close by. Look at your workplace. Look at your friends. Look at your family, but don't just look at your family, look beyond as well. Because the gospel, it spreads through us, brothers and sisters. It spreads through us, and Paul understood that. And then he goes on a little bit further, and then in verse 9, in Colossians 1:9, he says, ever since we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. And here's a special prayer. Do you ever wonder sometimes, how should I pray for people I have not met? Do you ever wonder that? Sometimes I pray, oh, God bless them, okay? And that's an okay prayer to pray, but let me give you a specific prayer to pray this morning. Paul says, I've not stopped praying for you and asking God to fill you with the knowledge of his will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. Why does God pray that? Why does Paul pray this and ask God to fill people with the knowledge of his will? It's not just, oh, read the Bible a lot so that you know a lot, but there's a prayer that he's praying. I want people to know this is what God's will is for them. This is what God wants for them in a spiritual way. And the next verse tells us why. Look at what comes next. And here we come to our theme this morning. In verse 10, he says, we pray this in order that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please him in every way. So this reminds us of Ephesians 4:1, living a life that's worthy of the high calling of God in our lives. So he says, I'm praying this so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and may please him in every way. I want to stop just a minute. I want you to look at this word worthy. This is the English word that we use. If we read Greek, this word would be axios, A-X-I-O-S, axios, and it has a special meaning. And when I was looking at it and studying yesterday, when I read about this word, my heart was struck. It was truly struck, because the word axios has a very simple but a very strong meaning. The word axios, or worthy, means literally of equal weight. Okay? Of equal weight. Now, I don't know about you, but when I understand that a worthy life is a life that is of equal weight, I take a step back and I have to look for a while at my life. Because here's the calling of God, and it's a high calling, and it's a special calling, and as we're going to see, it's a costly calling, it's holy, it cost God something, it is pure. Here is all of this on this side. And then Paul says, inspired of the Holy Spirit, the life that you and I live must be a worthy life. And that means our lives are to be of equal weight with the calling of God. Ouch. Yeah? It's an ouch. I don't know about you, it's an ouch for me. You may be further along the road than I am, but it's an ouch for me, of equal weight. Because a lot of times I compare my Christian life, if I compare it to other Christians or to other people, or certainly to the world, as we sometimes say, I'm in pretty good shape. I think, well, I'm a pastor. I gave up my secular job with a very good salary, and I gave up my car and the home where I lived so that I could serve the Lord as a missionary. And I can compare my life to others, and I can be quite complacent. And sometimes we can too, can't we? We really can. But that's not what it's about, brothers and sisters. The weighing and the comparison is with no one else around us, but it is with the call of God on our lives. And that's when I say ouch, the call of God. Our lives, the way that we live, are to be of equal weight with the call of God. That's serious, isn't it? That's really serious. And so we look at that, and I don't know about you, but it's kind of, that scares me just a little bit. It really does. It scares me. But Paul doesn't leave us hanging, and he doesn't leave us scared. He gives us really some simple things that show us, in part, what a worthy life is. Now, there are other things in other places. Ephesians 4 tells us some of the ways to live a worthy life. But right here in Colossians, he gives us four things that make up a worthy life. So let's look at them. And it says, and we can please him. The first one is bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power so that we can have endurance and patience. And then finally, joyfully giving thanks to the Father. So here are these four things. So I want us to take a minute and let's just look at them together. Let's look at the first one. The first one is bearing fruit in every good work. So here's the first type of life. Here's the first part of our lives that will be a worthy life and will also be pleasing to the Lord. So it'll be pleasing to the Lord. So both of these things. And so the first one is, a life that is worthy will bear fruit in every good work. And that should encourage you this morning, because sometimes we think God is only pleased with pastors because, you know, they do the big work, right? They do the important work. Only missionaries, they really please God. And that's not what Paul says at all. Paul says in every good work. To the Thessalonians, Paul says, let me just read this to you. It's not in the Chinese notes and it's not here. But let me read to you 2 Thessalonians 1:11. Listen carefully. Okay, 2 Thessalonians 1:11. We keep on praying for you, asking our God to enable you to live a life worthy of his call. Now, listen. May he give you the power to accomplish all the good things your faith prompts you to do. That encourages me. I don't know about you, because there are promptings in our heart, right? There are in her heart at times, I should do this and I should do that. And so that encourages me. It's not just, oh, what the pastors want us to do, what the church does. Paul says to us, what are the things that there's faith in your heart and your faith prompts you? Speak to this person, share a meal, show some love, do this, do that, do these things, and your faith is prompting you to do it. And you know what? That's part of a worthy life. That is that makes your life of equal weight with the call of God. So that should encourage you. I tell you, go back and on your own read 2 Thessalonians 1:11. May He give you the power, because we can't do it on our own, the power to accomplish all the good things your faith prompts you to do. Sometimes people say to us, why all of these missions to the Philippines? What about here? What about Hong Kong? I agree. What about Hong Kong? And my challenge to you is, what, not me, you, what is God prompting you to do? This is a challenge not to say to other people. This is a challenge for each one of us. It is. It's for each one of us. What is your faith prompting you to do that God will strengthen you to do? We'll come alongside you. We'll work together. We'll help. We'll do it together. The things that our faith prompts us to do, and we will bear fruit in every good work. So the life that is worthy of the high calling, it's a fruit-bearing life. It's productive. I'm not just receiving, I'm giving as well, and there's something growing in my life. What's the second one? Let's look at it. Look at it. The life that is worthy of the high call of God is a life that's growing in the knowledge of God. It's a life that's growing. And that encourages me as well. And that should encourage you. Do some of you think, I'm a baby Christian? I'm not ready yet? You know, others, the mature life, that's a worthy life. The mature life, that's a life that pleases God. That is not what Paul says. Paul says a life that is growing in the knowledge of God. So wherever you are in your Christian life, if you are growing, you're receiving, you're being transformed, you're changing, and things are happening in your life in the image of God, that is a life that's pleasing to God, and it's worthy of His high call. The third one is to be strengthened with all power according to His glorious might. This seems a little bit unusual, so that we may have great endurance and patience. This is a life that's pleasing to the Lord, a life that is receiving the power of God so that we have patience and endurance. Sometimes the Christian life is easy. Sometimes it is exciting. Sometimes things are happening. I'll tell you right now, medical mission was tough. I'm not gonna lie. I'd look at my face in the morning and I'd think, oh. And I had some makeup, but it didn't really cover things, as it doesn't this morning. But medical mission is really exciting. It is. There are things happening, people becoming Christians. It's exciting. But you know what? It's not always that way. At other times, it is just one step in front of the next. That's the Christian life sometimes. One step in front of another. And at other times, it's just hard. It's hard. You pray and it seems like there's no answer. You pray and things don't change. Things don't move. And it is those times when we must have the strength of God so that we can have patience and endurance. And sometimes, brothers and sisters, you bring joy and pleasure to the heart of God just by putting one foot in front of the other and keeping on walking with God. That's a worthy life. That's a worthy life. Let that encourage you this morning. Let that encourage you. But it doesn't stop there. We go a little bit further. And the fourth thing is, a life that is worthy of the high calling will joyfully, out of that life, joyfully give thanks to the Father. It will please the Lord. I'm around Christians sometimes that are very, not at Lighthouse, but sometimes ungrateful lives. Are you around people at times that are just, they're never really pleased with anything? They're never really satisfied? It's okay, but there's always a complaint. It's never quite good enough, and it's always kind of grumble, 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 murmur, murmur, murmur. Paul says the life that's pleasing to the Lord will be one that will joyfully give thanks. It really pleases, it really, really pleases him. And as I was thinking about this and preparing yesterday, I really understood this verse because in the medical mission for 2 weeks, I was doing reading glasses along with Sister Ida, and we had people helping us. And so we would help people, and most of the people we helped, they were so grateful, so grateful. And many of them would say, one old lady said, "You are the answer to prayer." She didn't even say thank you first. She said, "Thank you, God," which made us even happier. But she said, "You are the answer to prayer. When I heard that there was a medical mission, I prayed, God, let there be reading glasses so that I can get reading glasses and I can read my Bible." And more than one, many people said that. And there were people, and reading glasses is what I know about because that's the part I was in. But I'm sure there were people that were praying that for medical, for dental, in every area, in every area. And so many of them, they were so thankful. These, especially the elderly people, they would be so grateful. And they would just, sometimes they would even cry. They would be so grateful. I don't have time to go into the story right now. I'll tell you more later, but Pastor Renee gave his reading glasses. I still remember them. He said, "Hey, I've got a pair of reading glasses I'm not using anymore. Do you want to take them?" I was like, "Yeah, okay." He says, "I don't remember how strong they were." I said, "Just give them. We'll figure it out. We'll do something." So we got there, and he forgot to give them to me the first day, and I forgot because I was so busy. And then the second day, he just happened to say, here are the reading glasses. So I took them and put them in the box, but I didn't really, you know, we were doing other things. I had all the other glasses worked out and set out. I knew their strengths. And then one lady came late in the afternoon, and we did the test, and we tried all of the glasses. We could not find a pair of glasses for her. Could not find a pair, truly. And what Ida and I would do as we would find this is difficult, we would just start praying under our breath, "Lord, find the right glasses." Really, miracles. We'll tell you about it another time. And I just happened to remember Pastor Renee's glasses. I didn't even know, will this work? Will it not? What strength are they? No idea. Really, it was a step in the dark. It really was. But thank goodness that God was in the darkness. And I reached in and I got it. Said, "Let's try these." She got them out. She put them on. She looked at the page and she went, "Oh, so clear, so clear." Boom, just like that. You don't think God arranged that? I'm serious. You don't think God arranged that? Perfect arrangement. And then I said, "I want you to know how much God loves you." And I told her the story. And she went out of there. She was so grateful. She was so grateful. And she went around saying, she said, "I have Pastor Renee's glasses. I have Pastor Renee's glasses." We'll show you a picture. Really. And she was so joyful. She was so thankful. She wasn't like, "Well, these glasses are different from the other glasses." "I have Pastor Renee's glasses." And it was a little bit like the woman at the well saying, "Come and see. He told me everything about myself." She was grabbing people in the medical mission saying, "Look, these glasses were just for me. They're Pastor Renee's glasses." She found Brother Stephen. She says, "Look, Brother Stephen, I have Pastor Renee's glasses." She was so thankful, and we laugh at that, and it was funny, but she was so overjoyed. She was so thankful. You don't think that God planned that? Of course He did. Of course He did. And her heart overflowed with thanksgiving. And then there were others that we'd give them glasses, and unfortunately, often some of the younger ones are those that were more well-to-do. There were some that would take the glasses and just walk off, leave the table, never say thank you, truly never say thank you. And we'd sit there and we'd think, So we were really glad. Our hearts were so happy for the people who overflowed in thanksgiving. Not like, "Oh, I'm so proud they said thank you to me." It wasn't that. You understand that, don't you? And so that's why I tell you that story in detail, to help you understand how God feels when you and I are thankful to Him. Really, it just pleases Him no end when we respond in thanksgiving to Him. Oh, how He loves it when His children say, "God, thank you, you're so good to me." Even in hard times, There's something for which we can praise the Lord. And the life that is worthy of the high calling of God will be a life that is overflowing in thanks to the Father. Now, you and I might say this morning, it's a little bit hard for me to praise the Lord this morning. You don't know the trouble I'm going through. I'm going through some hard times. May I give you an encouragement that will help you with thanksgiving this morning? Paul writes it right after this verse, and he says in the verse that follows, in verses 13 and 14, he gives us a reason to joyfully give thanks to the Lord. And he says, "For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness, and he has brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." Brothers and sisters, anytime you and I have a hard time remembering things for which to be thankful, this is when you and I can look back and we can remember that God brought us out of the dominion of darkness. He brought us out of the dominion of darkness. He brought us out. The dominion of darkness, just stay there. He brought us out of the dominion of darkness. A dominion is a kingdom. It's a place where there is a powerful person in control. And you and I were in the dominion of darkness. Satan had you, and he had me too. And we were in chains, and we were in bondage. We were bound. And he got us out. He did what? Rescued us. Rescued us. He rescued us. He called us out of darkness, as it says in 1 Peter 2. Look at that very quickly. 1 Peter 2, 9 and 10. "That you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light." Into his wonderful light. Let that speak to your heart and my heart. It was powerful. It wasn't easy. Do you think Satan wanted to let go of you easily when God began to call you? You think so? No. Satan was going to keep you. He wasn't going to let you go. He had his grip upon you. He had your life and he had my life. But Jesus came and he rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and he called us out of darkness. That reminds me of Jesus standing at the tomb of Lazarus, where Lazarus is dead and buried and stinking for 4 days. And Jesus doesn't just say, "Okay, Lazarus, I'm giving you life. You can come out." Jesus, the Bible says in John 11:34, Jesus says, it is recorded, "Then Jesus cried out with a loud voice, 'Lazarus, come out!'" It took something powerful to bring out Lazarus from the dead and into life. It took something powerful to get you and me out of our dead state and into life. It took something powerful to get us from darkness into light. But our Jesus was powerful because he paid the price. He paid the price. And so we see part of the price in the high calling. That's the high calling. That's on that side. That's where our lives have to weigh up. That's where our lives have to weigh up. It cost something. And we read in 1 Peter 1, 18 and 19. Look at that. He says, Peter says, "You know it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold." Whew. We love silver and gold, don't we? We love valuable, precious things and diamonds and this and that. God, it took something more to save you and save me. It was something powerful, and it was the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish, a lamb without defect. That's what it takes. That's part of the high calling of God. This is what it took for your life and for my life. And when you understand that, and when I understand that, it helps me to choose to live differently than I am living now. It helps me to live higher than I am living right now. It helps me to live a more holy life than I'm living now. It helps me to live a life that is more heavenward than I am living now. That is what it is to live a holy life, to live a worthy life that is worthy of the high calling. We close with this, Philippians 3:12 through 14. He says, here's Paul, and he says, I haven't gotten it all, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. This is the calling. I haven't yet taken hold of it, but one thing I do, I forget what's behind, and I strain towards what is ahead. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has what? Called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Brothers and sisters, it is a high call, but it is a call to live a worthy life. We can live a worthy life because of the high call and the price that Jesus paid for us. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's close in prayer this morning. Amen. Lord, we thank you for the words that you inspired Paul to write and Peter to write. Lord, we thank you for others' lives that we look at and we see them and we know that their lives are worthy lives. But Lord, you're calling us also to live worthy lives. Lord, some of us you're calling for salvation, to respond to you. And Lord, we want to do that this morning. We just want to say yes to you. Lord, some of us have said yes to you in the past, but we have gotten busy and careless, and we've drifted some, and our lives have gotten full of other things. And so, Lord, we open our ears this morning again to hear your call on our lives. We do want to live worthy lives, lives that are of equal weight with your high calling. What you paid for, what you paid with when you got us out of darkness and you got us out of death and you brought us into light and you gave us your life. May we live lives that are bearing fruit for you. May we live lives that are growing in the knowledge of you. May we live lives that are being strengthened with your strength for patience and endurance in this life. And may we live lives that are overflowing with joy and thankfulness to you for what you have done. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. 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 God bless you, dear brothers and sisters.